And finally, Jeremiah 51, verse 60 to verse 64. So those are all references that show you that the Old Testament prophets were told by God to write these words. 61 from verse 60 to verse 64. In the New Testament, John chapter 14, verse 26, and John chapter 16, verse 12 to 13, Jesus says, "And when the Holy Spirit comes, he will teach you all things, and he will cause you to remember all things that I have commanded." Jeremiah chapter 14, verse 26. John chapter 14, verse 26, and John chapter 16, verse 12 to 13. Okay. We together there? So you will read it and you will see that John 14, verse 26, John 16, verse 12 to 13. Then in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 10, I read this at church yesterday. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 10, and also chapter 14, verse 37, Paul says in chapter 7, verse 10, that, "And I tell you this about the married people," where it says they should not divorce, he says, "Not I, but the Lord commands it." When he's giving the instruction about how a married person should live, or how an unmarried person should live, he says, "It is not I who's telling you this." Amen. This is a command from the Lord that I'm writing down. Yeah. In verse 37, when he's talking about the issue about tongues and about how the prophecies and how they should be carried out in the church, he says that all of you should understand that these are commands from the Lord. This is not just my personal opinion. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
That's true.
I apologize for the interruption.
I'm not totally here.
I'm not totally here. Okay. God, you forgive me. God bless everybody.
All right, why don't we finish together? I was just about finishing.
Okay.
Yeah, we can just sit over there, just so that we can finish well. Finally, sit down just for a moment. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 2. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 2 is the last one we shall look at. I was actually just winding up. It's alright, you can just listen, because we are just winding up. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 2. This is what the scripture says. It says, "I want you to recall the words spoken in the past by the holy prophets and the command given by our Lord and the Savior through your apostles." So, Peter is writing, he's saying, "I want you to remember the words spoken by the Lord to the holy prophets and the words spoken by the Lord to his apostles." It says, "I want you to be very careful to always be mindful of those words, because they are the very words of God, and they are the words that are recorded in the New Testament and in the Old Testament." In 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 16, it says that all scripture from Genesis to Revelation is inspired by God himself. It's not the thoughts of the prophets, it's not the thoughts of the apostles, but rather it is God himself who spoke them to these people. Okay? Now, notice that what we are presented with in the Bible is the last one that we looked at. The written words of God. The speech of God, that is the decrees of God. The speech of God, that is the public, the personal address of God. I'm summarizing now. And the speech of God through human lips, inasmuch as it is authoritative, unless it is in written form, it cannot be relied upon. Do you understand what I just said? In other words, if you come to me and you say, "The Lord spoke to me last night." Okay? "The Lord spoke to me last night. So you must obey what I'm about to tell you." That cannot be relied upon. Why? Because you could be hearing from the devil.
Okay, thank you.
Muhammad heard from the devil actually. The devil appeared to Muhammad and told him, I am an angel from God. And God had already given the scriptures to the Jews, and he had already given the scriptures to the Christians, and now these people have not obeyed, so I'm going to give you a new word. And so Muhammad wrote a book called the Quran. Okay? But he had from them. How do we know that it is from Satan? Because the Quran is the opposite of the Bible. So it cannot be the same God coming and saying, oh, by the way, I bless Ishmael, not Isaac. Because that's what the Quran says, that Ishmael is blessed, not Isaac. The Bible says, I bless Isaac, not
Ishmael.
So the Quran says that Esau was blessed, not Jacob. So it takes everything and turns it around. So that's why it is not reliable in and of itself. The only way it is reliable is if you come to me and tell me, God spoke to me in a voice yesterday, okay? What did he say to you? He says, Pastor, you need to repent of your sins. Immediately, I will ask myself, is that in the Bible? And it is very much so in the Bible, isn't it?
Right.
And then secondly, I will ask myself, am I actually doing something that I need to repent of? Mm-hmm. And if it is from God, I will know immediately, wow, I've been caught. Okay? But if you come to me and say, God told me that in 1 week, you're going to receive $1 million. Okay?
Okay.
I'm not going to say it's wrong. I'm going to say, okay, let us wait and see. 7 days from now, if I don't receive $1 million, I will know God did not speak to me. So if 7 days pass and I don't receive $1 million, I don't care if you tell me, well, you didn't believe. No, you said that God said. You didn't say that if you believe, you said if God, that God said. Okay? So therefore, why we must only, when we are studying this course, we will only be looking at only the written word, not what people say they had from the Lord, not the visions that they had. That's why you will always hear, even if I give you a vision that I saw, I will always tell you, let us look at it in the Bible.
Yes.
Because we read in Deuteronomy 29 that the things that are hidden belong to God. But the things that have been revealed belong to us, and the only way to confirm that they have been revealed is that they will conform directly with Scripture. They will never contradict Scripture.
Amen.
Everything that you say God told you must come from Scripture as a minister. It must never be from your own thoughts or what you slept, because that could be from the devil. The devil can also affect your dreams. Okay? So, there are three advantages. You can write them down very quickly. Three advantages to the written word that it has over every other form of the word of God. Number one, accurate preservation. Because something that is written, like Moses, what Moses wrote 3,000 years ago, it is still with us, isn't it?
It is.
Accurate preservation. In other words, now listen to this. If you give a word, let's say a word is spoken here, right? And it's passed on. Let's say, like for instance, my brother was not here last week, Steve, right? If now I walk out and I tell you guys, tell him what I said last week, what is probably going to happen? He's going to get a lot of what I said, but he's also going to get a lot of what I did not say. Right? Now, can you imagine now if Steve, because he has said there are some other people who want to come and join us, they come next week and he says, Steve, you tell them what was said. By the time it is said the third time, it is completely wrong, twisted. But something that is written can be preserved over time. And that's what the Bible is. Secondly, the advantage of the written scriptures and why we must always depend only on the written scriptures is because the written scriptures have the opportunity for inspection.
Amen.
Opportunity for inspection. In other words, if there is a conflict, you can go back in many times and inspect it. You can study it from this direction, from that direction. Okay? So that every one of us will be sure. Nobody can say it is because Pastor Steve said so. Okay? Opportunity for inspection. In other words, none of you will ever be able to say before God, it is because Pastor Steve taught it like that. God will say, but did you have a copy of the Bible yourself?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Did I put you in an opportunity to actually learn how to read? Yes. Then it means you have to put those two together. I might teach it, but you must go and sit down and study it yourself.
Amen.
And be convinced yourself, because you will stand before God by yourself.
Amen.
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 Number three, the written word has an advantage over all other forms of the word of God, apart from Jesus Christ, of course, because it is accessible in all places at all times. Okay? The written word is accessible in all places at all times. What do I mean by that? In other words, right now as we are doing this Bible study, there may be somebody in China doing a Bible study just like this, reading the same Bible. The people in Africa are reading the same Bible. The people in South America are reading the same Bible. But if it was a word that was received audibly, they cannot receive it until we take it to them. Right? And in that case, it is only the person who received it who can take it there. What about when the person dies? Then now we are dealing with secondhand
information.
Amen. So the doctrine of the Word of God only focuses on what is written in the Word of God, acknowledging that not everything about God is written in the Word, but that everything that needs to be known about God is written in the Word. So what we have in the Bible is not everything that exists in knowledge, but it is everything that you need for salvation. It is everything that you need for your life. Praise the Lord. Amen. That will be the end of our study tonight, so that we can release those who must run. I know it has taken longer today, but I wanted to finish that part.
Amen.
Amen. So we are going to pray, and then I'm going to release those who have to run. But if anybody has any questions about the things that we have talked about, because this is lecture style, as you can notice, at the end is when we ask questions. So let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for taking us through an understanding of what the Word of God means according to your Word. We thank you, Lord, for making it so clear that Jesus Christ is the Word of God and He is the second person in the Trinity. We thank you, God, that even the words that we now have in the Bible have been sanctioned and ordained by you through the medium of the Holy Spirit, through the person of the Holy Spirit. King of Kings, we ask you that now as we go deeper into this study of the Word of God in the next few weeks, that we will become good students, that we will become good ministers, and that we will become good teachers of this word. So that, Lord, we are not misconstruing your word, we are not abusing your word, and Lord, that we are actually bringing people unto salvation through your written word. We thank you and we honor you, God, for all that you have done here today. And it is in Jesus' name that we pray and that we believe.
Amen.
Amen. And amen. Let us share the grace. And now the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, in the love of God, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us now and forevermore.
Amen.
Amen. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever.
Amen.
If you have any questions, you can ask. Those are going to run, have to run. Yes, copy.
We were talking about, and I've read this on my own, but I never really understood. Nobody can enter into heaven, flesh and blood. Well, what about Enoch?
Oh, Enoch and? Now, Enoch, first of all, we don't even know. Okay? Because the Bible just says about Enoch, he walked with God and then he was not.
Right.
So we don't know how Enoch entered into heaven. Now, the second person is Elijah. Okay? Now, the Bible says about Elijah that they went to the river with Elisha, and Elisha saw a chariot of fire come and whisk Elijah away and take him into heaven. Right? That's what the Bible says. Now, let me ask you this, because I want to answer that question to you, right? How does the Bible tell us, how does Jesus tell us what will happen to those who will be alive when he comes back? They will be changed in a moment, right? Those who are dead will be raised to life, but those who remain alive, they will not die, but they will be
changed.
They will be changed. They will be caught up to heaven, right? And since we know that the Word of God is consistent with itself, then the only thing that I can say about that is that my personal belief, now notice I'm saying my personal belief because the Bible does not continue to say, my personal belief is that when Elijah was taken into heaven, he was changed. Or his body, he left his body wherever it was left, but he did not enter heaven with his body. We know that. As a matter of fact, we know that Elijah did not enter the place called the heaven of heavens. He entered into paradise, which you cannot enter with this body. Just the same as Moses. Okay? Now, if you look at Luke chapter 19, I believe. Might be 18 or 19. But if you look at that, there is what is called the transfiguration. Okay?
What is it?
The transfiguration.
What? Luke what?
Don't go with the scripture because right now I'm just kind of saying, look for the transfiguration.
Okay.
Transfiguration. In the transfiguration, Jesus is visited by both Moses and Elijah. Right? But they appear as spirits. They don't appear as men. So we know that whatever happened to Moses must have happened to Elijah. But we know that Moses, he died and he was taken into heaven and his body was there. So whatever God did with Elijah's body, we don't know, but we do know that he entered heaven. Amen. I hope that answers that question. But that is a very, very wonderful question. Oh, go ahead. This question then.
The whole situation with Moses died, his body, and how that Satan was trying to get his body. Uh-huh. And I think it might have been
Judah.
Yeah. Okay. I'm confused about that too. Like, why did he want his? Or I mean, I know that from what I read, is that I couldn't understand. Like, why would he want his body?
Again, the Bible doesn't tell us why. Okay? Just tells us that when Moses died, now this is in the New Testament in Jude, that Satan came to contend over his body.
Right.
Okay? Again, we can only speculate. The Bible doesn't tell us why. And my personal belief is that Satan wanted to take Moses' body so that he can either desecrate it or so that he can use it for some purpose that would actually bring the faith of the people down. Okay? Because the Bible says that when Moses died, he was not sick, he was not old, he was 120 years old, he actually talked to the people, then he walked up the mountain, and he went, and he died, and God took him, and his body was left. And God himself, the Bible says that God buried Moses. So I would imagine that Satan would want that body so that he could do something to it, so that he could come and display it before the Israelites. Okay? That's one reason. As a form of, you know how sometimes people desecrate bodies as a form of bringing fear? Okay? Yeah, people do that. Yeah, that's why you see dictators in Africa and other places. Once they kill them, they cut off their heads and then they'll parade their body all over so that their followers will be scared. Like, wow, we are dealing. Why do you think the Muslims are cutting people's heads off? It's to instill fear. Because you really don't need to cut somebody's heads off to kill them, you can just shoot them. But you rather just, so that's one reason. But the other reason is this. The Bible says that when Jesus comes back, we will, wherever somebody is buried, is where they will be raised up at.
Right.
Okay? So it is possible, again, these are just speculations. It is possible that it is for that reason, that's why even God wants us to bury people in honor and in respect. Because when he comes to resurrect people, it will be changing that body, changing that person at the grave where they were buried.
This side is for us.
So I believe that Satan just wanted to cause confusion.
Right.
But those are very good questions. I've never had them before. Alright. What about you, Steven? Good. Very good. I know today's class was longer than the rest, but I had to cover all that material. I wanted to cover all that material. So thank you very much for coming.
Anything or what?
No, for this one, especially because the others are gone, I will just pick up from there because now we will start getting into it is more of the doctrine of the word. What I want us to be doing, and I will communicate with the others, is the stuff that we have studied today. I want you now to go back into all those scriptures, study them, understand them, because when we do the test, it will be on that material.
Okay.
It will be on that material that we studied today. Because I will test you, for instance, I will ask in the test, what are the two forms of the words of God that are written in written form? And what are the scripture references? So in other words, if you have not studied it, if you don't remember, it will be kind of hard for you to pass in that. Because the text that I'm using, just so you know, because some of you might be in a position, this is the text that I'm using to teach the class. Yes. It's called Society by Gooden. Lifeway Bible Store. Now I'm using a couple of others, of course, just as references, but that is the main text that I'm using. But Lifeway Bible Store. Out in Lifeway. Lifeway is out in Bridgetown. I think it was number 44, something I can remember. When I bought it was 49.
Lifeway.
Yeah, Lifeway. And I can text it to you.
Lifeway.
Yeah. Lifeway Bible Store. So it was good for you to come. We appreciate it. Good for you to come. You have more questions?
Yes, just one question.
Okay, let me turn this off and then I'll answer as many. Don't just say just one. If you have many more,
no.